Yeah, there is a street thing.
Okay, thank you, folks. Okay, hello, folks. How are you? And welcome to the city planning meeting for the city of Reading this evening, month of October. I'd like to introduce myself. We haven't been here for 3 months, which is a record. I'm Reddy Raffaelli. I'm a member of the Planning Commission, and I would like to introduce to you our two new staff members that we have. Our Director of Planning Services, Mr. David Hunter.
Good evening.
And also our planner, Adam Thomas.
Good evening.
And you'll be seeing a lot of these gentlemen. We have a new zoning officer, Mr. David Harris, who is not here.
Not here tonight.
He's not here tonight, but he will also be here in the future. And we have a new member of our Planning Commissioners group, Mr. Lee Olson. Stand, wave, Lee. Everyone in the community should know Lee by now. He's very, very active, and he said he wanted to relocate to a commission that's very active, and he's a change agent, so he's a good man. Tonight we have a very short agenda.
Thank you.
We have one item for subdivision and land development. And basically, it is 1722 North 10th Street, a preliminary plan for Ronald Mercedes concerning a truck parking lot. So I guess we'll start with our regular format of business. This will be our regular meeting time. Come on, join us.
Identify the property and give the staff recommendations.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'll discuss it. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we did. Just another reminder, all those who are going to be presenters this evening, please sign the signing sheet so that we have it recorded in our minutes. We thank you for that. All right, first order of business is acceptance of the October 2018 Planning Commission agenda, our agenda for this evening.
I move to accept the agenda.
Motion has been made to accept.
I'll second that.
Second by Mr. Beeler. Question on the motion?
Are there any, I guess we forgot to ask if there's any additions or changes?
Any additions, changes? Being none, call for the vote. All those in favor of the agenda for this evening, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? We are unanimous. Yes. Thank you, folks. Our first order of business on this agenda is under subdivisions and land development is a preliminary plan for Ronald Mercedes at 1722 North 10th Street regarding a proposed land development of a parcel, Berks County. PIN numbers, being at 722 North 10th Street, purpose to convert the property into truck parking lot for tractor trailers and passenger vehicles. This is being prepared by Ludgate Engineering as expressed in a land development plan. The following items submitted for review include the application form with the appropriate fee and 12 plan sheets. The submission did not include the subject deed or the driver's license identification. I'll go around Robin first with to see if you have comments. But first, the Director of Planning Services.
Adam is going to give us a staff presentation.
Okay, this is Adam's. Adam, do you have comments to the commission?
I do have comments at this time. The staff comments has been passed out to the members of the commission in a report earlier, but I want to read into the record my testimony on the comments and recommendations. Okay. 1722 North 10th Street, the tractor-trailer parking lot. This is a preliminary land development plan. This is the first presentation for the proposed conversion of a 60,300-square-foot lot into a tractor-trailer and vehicle parking lot at the parcel also known as 1722 North 10th Street. It should be noted that the site is currently being used as a tractor-trailer parking site. The comments are as follows. According to the previous ZHB testimony, truck traffic will be entering and exiting the subject property between midnight and 4:00 p.m. or almost 24 hours a day. Based on planning principles, because there are stable residential neighborhoods directly bordering and adjacent to the subject property, increased traffic, including trucks and commercial vehicles entering and departing the property, staff believes that this presents a significant health and safety issue, generating increased levels of commercial traffic with its associated fumes and noise, which are detrimental to the continued stabilization of a residential neighborhood. In addition, this office does not recommend locating a general freight trucking type use with late hours and large commercial vehicle trucks at this location. North 10th Street is a gateway block between industrial Reading and residential areas, and the use along this block should be harmonious and compatible with the existing residential uses. The trucking company is not compatible with the existing mix of uses along Exeter Avenue. Further residential units are located along the truck's ingress and egress routes, and trucking would not be compatible with the existing residential properties adjacent to the site. Accordingly, the planning office recommends denial of this application.
You have heard commentary by the planner. Now, for comments by the commission, go round robin. Mr. Beard, is there anyone else that has...
Mr. Gardell is here to present the plan.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize that.
Yes, I'm...
Would you please, the presenters up here in the front, please?
Okay.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't really...
Adam, do you have, I read this, but do you have an extra one here?
No.
No, I have it, but just for reference. Okay, thank you. I didn't print it out, you know.
Well, I didn't bring the easel in here. So I guess what I could do is, first of all, let me ask you a question. We brought, I think it was 11 sets of plans. Nobody here has any plans?
Yes.
You do have the plan?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Good, okay. So I'll just explain that if you have plans.
I might add that the commission members always receive their plans at least a week ahead of the office, ahead of the meeting.
Right.
And they have had enough time to review these. So we've had these at our homes.
You have not had time to review them?
We have.
Oh, you haven't?
We have.
I have, oh, okay. Okay, good, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Because I thought he just said he was going to not accept it. Mr. Adam?
Recommendation.
Our recommendation from the office.
I see.
To the board.
Okay, well, here's the thing. We went to the zoning, and the main thing was to try to get them to agree that this is okay to use for the tractor-trailer parking. And so they did agree to that. They did agree to it. So we have that all taken care of. No problem. So the next step was, do we even need to go with a land development plan? Because we're not really changing the lot in any major way. I'm just trying to give you the history.
Yeah, well, once again, it confounds me how your company never reads the saldo.
Yeah, we read the saldo all the time, actually.
And what does the saldo say about parking lots?
The saldo.
What does the city of Reading saldo say about parking lots?
First of all, we're looking at number one. Let's get the zoning approved first before we can even move to that.
Correct.
Land development.
Correct. But now you're questioning why this is land development. And what does the city of Reading saldo say about parking lots?
I'm not questioning why it's land development. I'm simply saying that we sent it in to get the zoning, and there was no clear cut anything about whether it should go to land development.
Yes, in the Saldo, it's clear cut what type of parking lots have to go to land development. And what does it say?
Okay, I don't know, maybe I missed that.
It says anything above 10 spaces.
Okay, so anyway, it's in land development. Because I think there could be some, in some cases, maybe someone would say, well, in this case, there's an exception or something of that nature, okay?
We never have exceptions for parking lots over 10 spaces. I've been on here 15 years.
Okay.
Never have we had an exception.
Okay, fine. Now, so we said, we didn't know for sure for whatever reason, because it didn't say in the zoning big long letter we got at the end that said it's okay to go with this, whether we absolutely had to go to land development. But then we got the, we sent it in to land development because I guess we figured we should do that. And then thinking that maybe they would say, well, IEU people would say, well, maybe this one doesn't need to go, for whatever reason. So now it's here. So
and once again, this is from your company not understanding the city of Reading Saldo.
Okay.
You know, it just amazes me how every representative from your company comes in here and doesn't know what we do.
Okay. I'll make sure everybody knows that.
You know, the last time I had to reprimand your representative because of all the cutting and pasting and all the problems with the cutting and pasting into the plan. Because you used an outdated plan and most of the stuff was not true.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to make a couple points if I may. Zoning is zoning, and land development is land development. There's separate ordinances, as I'm sure the applicant's aware, just again for the general public's benefit as well. There's a zoning ordinance, and then there's the subdivision and land development ordinance, the SALDO. Second, just as a point of personal privilege, we're all volunteers. We all enjoy, we have a new person here for the first time, we all enjoy doing this for the city, and we have plans that are deficient, and we come back month after month on the same thing. So this is some of the frustration that's being expressed because there's a history here. So we're here to review this plan now, and that's, just to be, so you understand where we're coming from, and, what my colleague is, to validate his concerns. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, anyway, okay, so we've established that it is being reviewed as a land development plan. So, when we sit in for zoning, we did a lot of things you normally wouldn't do for like a zoning hearing. Like we gave a lighting plan and landscaping plan and things like that, which normally don't even do. So that's okay. We got that. So it was kind of like, in reality, kind of like a zoning plan and a subdivision land development plan, as you might say. But except for, we didn't really go into a lot of detail on stormwater, because again, the initial idea was to just use the lot as it is, in other words, with not any buildings or excavation, any grading work done. So anyway, so we have a plan to show these existing conditions, as you know. Then we had a landscaping plan, and we had a truck turning plan to show the radius and how to get in and out. And we sent in these plans to see what your reaction would be, and to see what comments you had. That's what we sent it in for, and to get, hopefully, a land development plan approval. That's what we sent it in for. So now,
Again, Mr. Chairman, just so it's clear, it's a requirement, and we appreciate the voluntary thought, but it's a requirement under. Okay, that's what we're trying to establish.
I understand.
All right, let's go on. Mr. Beal, do you have any additional comments?
Okay,
then I'll go around Rob and then.
Yeah, okay. I'll start with your existing conditions plan. It doesn't show the existing city city sanitary sewer lateral that goes through the property. At least I couldn't see it. I couldn't find it.
I don't see it either.
Okay.
If it runs through the property, we're certainly be glad to show it.
Okay. Because the Stackhouse Bensinger was able to field verify that it's there because supposedly it's at the surface.
Hmm.
You also
have to ask the surveyors if maybe they shot it, but maybe it just got left off by accident or.
Okay. And the reason for that is that the previous time that this plan, that a review was done on this property, the Public Works Department asked for easement to ask for a drainage easement and for easements to get to the sewer lateral.
Okay. They're usually pretty good about picking everything up, but being it's a lateral, maybe they just didn't. Maybe there was no. Unless it's sticking up out of the ground, they should have shot it.
Supposedly, it's at the surface.
The land records issue. Okay. If you search the land records, you would get the easements for the property.
Okay.
If I could just speak for Public Works, I vaguely remember this. This goes back to the GJ's office.
Right.
I wasn't here for those meetings, but I did review it in depth, focus, and maybe the issue.
Yeah.
Actually,
the minutes show that no one was here for Public Works at that time.
Okay. We did review it, and if it was a lateral, it was shown, probably the vents came out. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that would be good to show, but I guess I don't see any future tie-in to that.
Right, there's no tie-in.
The plan should show that.
Sure, though. It should show it, yeah. If there's one, put the rod on it.
Yeah, and that's something we want to see. The 15-foot wide easement, I remember the stormwater management, there was a stormwater management plan with a pond and some BMP features, which we wanted to have a municipal stormwater easement, which gives us the right to enter upon that property to do inspections, to develop inspections. And that was the reason for the easement, as opposed to the blanket. Sometimes it's a blanket because it's a small site blanket, as opposed to 15-foot. Now, that's what I'm recalling.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'll have to go back and do a review of that to make sure that's what we were talking about. But when it comes to easements, since this isn't a building, it's a different land development, it would require a different look at as far as what easement would be required. I believe when we get into the talking about stormwater, I can get into that a little bit more when we talk about easements and stuff. That's what I recall from the history.
Right.
It's a little fuzzy, but it has.
Yeah. Yeah. And actually, I didn't even remember that stuff. All what I remembered was the street vacation problem.
Yeah.
And then when I started reading the minutes, it was like all of a sudden, oh, well, there was all this other questions, right, that we had about this.
And Ed, was this presented already? Did you already present this before? This looks
Well, we presented these plans at the zoning hearing.
I'm thinking last year, was there a sketch plan or something?
Not to the planning commission itself, no, okay. I don't think. I think we just.
Because this looks familiar, and I remember talking to you about it, what, 6 or 8 months ago? It's not the first time.
I'm sorry, I forget everybody. What's your name?
Yeah, I'm Tim Crawl.
You're Tim, the engineer. Yeah. Okay, yeah, I'm sure I can talk to you.
Yeah, we talk on the phone and email. You don't see
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was mainly with the zoning people.
Okay.
Because it was, you know, a few times we had to go over there and then we went over, and then they would give us a lot of comments. And I know people have changed. Okay. The guy that was there is not there anymore.
Okay.
The zoning man. I forget his name, too.
Craig Pfeiffer.
No, that would have been Keith.
That was a guy after Keith.
Keith. Oh, okay. Keith
Zahner.
That's the guy, Keith Zahner.
I'm just saying, because this looks really familiar, and we're talking about turning.
We sent it over to you. That's right. We sent the plans over.
I remember.
That's correct.
Yes.
We did.
You did send it to me. Okay.
I talked to you about it.
So it wasn't a sketch plan. It was just something sent over to Public
Works.
Oh,
okay.
Right. Yeah, probably. That's right. And then we had the hearing, and they finally said, okay.
Okay. Thank you. That helps me get caught up.
Yeah, that's right.
Great. Back then, there were also references to a railroad spur on the property?
Yes. Yeah, there's a railroad right here, Norfolk Southern Railroad.
No, there's a spur that goes through the property.
Through the property?
Yeah.
Okay, there's no, apparently, no, I guess, evidence of it for the survey.
And the problem why a lot of this didn't get resolved is that the county withdrew their plan. So a lot of this research never got completed.
The county withdrew which plan?
For the magisterial district office that was presented to us in 2014. And then, you know, you can catch up on the emails that I sent this afternoon.
They got it pretty far.
Oh, they got it pretty far, and then they withdrew it.
Right.
Yeah. And then the last thing from that review that we need to research is that the engineer for the applicant at that time mentioned that on the topographical map, there's still parts of Moss Street showing.
I remember the railroad, it says Conrail.
And there's so
the easement along the northwest corner was a question. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. And then
that you had to add to. Mm-hmm. That would be something.
Yes, that's correct. So yeah. There was a question. Mm-hmm. Maybe you brought it up. Somebody brought it up.
Yeah, that was last over.
And we did a lot of, I personally, we did a lot of calling to find out who. Right. We thought we finally got to the right person, Norfolk Southern. And she sent us an email that said, yes, I agree with you, that this is not, I don't see any evidence that this is going to be in our right of way. So we went to the zoning hearing with that information. That was another thing we had to get okay for, because they asked that question. And we presented that evidence or that response back from her, and that was it. It's really tricky to find out these right-of-ways along the railroad. I mean, even the people.
Oh, everybody has problems.
I mean, it's
when it comes to the railroad.
I mean, even this woman was a little. She did everything. Looked everywhere. But she finally said, "Yes." And based on what the evidence she had, she said, "You're not in it." So we resolved that. And then when they asked for the lighting plan, this is the zoning people after the lighting plan. And so we gave them a lighting plan. Then they said landscape, we gave them a landscaping plan. And truck turning radius plan. And so they reviewed. So here we are at the Planning Commission, and now you're looking at it and giving your comments. So the comment you just gave me, though, are we going to get a hard copy of this at some point?
I can send this to you.
Yeah, please, because otherwise I can start writing here, scribbling.
Yeah, down. No. I can send you the email that I'm reading from, that I sent to the staff.
Or whatever your specific comments were about, like for instance, the sewer lateral not being shown.
It's really following here.
Okay, good. Great.
Yeah. So yeah, I can just send you this as a reminder for that. So I don't know what kind of research we would have to do to see if Moss Street still exists in that area. But there was a question about it back in 2014.
I see Kutztown Road, Burn Street. I see 10th Street. I don't see the Moss Road. Oh, here's Clover Street.
Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yes.
If it pleases the commission, it can defer decision and give staff time to do the adequate research on the easements and work with the applicant to come up with whatever's out there in land records that needs mm-hmm. to be on the plan. Right. Obviously, we don't have answers tonight.
Yeah.
So we would recommend that, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Right. Mr. Chairman, if I may piggyback on that, I didn't know about Moore Street. I mean, I joined the commission in 2014, it must have been a few months after the magisterial district judge. Mm-hmm. I remember that from being in the news. My question was on Clover Street. Clover Street right now, it is, it looks like a part of the parking lot of Williams Restaurant, between Williams and Alloy Metals. And I've wondered for some time if that was ever, if it were ever vacated, and if so, I mean, did it ever extend, you know, the 1700 block of Clover, did it ever extend further north? Or did it end partway? Was part of it vacated and part not? So that would just add that to the, I really appreciate the research on that, in terms of any rights of way, and then vacation of streets, whatever issues would be with that. Just wanted to add that to that, thank you.
And that's all the comments I have until we talk about a truck, recommended truck route.
Okay. I have a few things. Let's you want to go this way?
Mr. Olson.
I would pass.
Pass.
You sure?
Mr. Sinfisi.
Okay, a few things. That was one. I see there are two per parts. Is this line the division between the two? It's not clear. I can't see on the legend.
Yeah, the per part is pretty small.
The one on the west side is a small, is that
the boundary? It's right along 10th Street.
I think our question is, again, something to research, I suppose, I mean, maybe by the applicant in this case, is, although I suppose it's good the city did it, are these really two per parts? This question has come up already. Are these two per parts or two parcels? And if so, would they need to be consolidated? I don't know if they would be if they were per parts of the same parcel, right? They wouldn't have to be consolidated.
I have a question to Adam and David about that in an email, because the the county GIS system just shows one parcel.
Yeah. Okay. So if it is two per part, we'd have to have the history on that to be certain. If it is, then it shouldn't be a problem.
Yeah, and a parcel lookup of the second PIN number that they have provided provides no information in the county database,
and I think
which is kind of weird.
I think we've seen that per parts can have different PINs with being the same parcel, but we don't know for sure. So we'd have to add that to what needs to be...
We might have to have Michelle look into that for us.
I think the only other things I had were just one, there was some comments on the landscape plan. It's not Acer rubrum, the Norway maple is some other Acer species. I can't remember what it's called, but anyway, we don't. The arborist won't allow the Norway maple because it's an invasive species.
Invasive tree.
So check with the arborist. There's a whole series of recommended species that you can pick from, you know, and then we of course we alternate and all that. There's the whole guidelines on that, so you won't have to go out on a limb. And I guess the next question is, we come to the flow of the truck movement. So I'll defer to my colleague who wants to raise that issue. So I think I covered everything for now.
Okay, I guess I'm up a couple of issues. I saw the size of the small office, 8 foot square, that I take was an exterior dimension.
Yes.
That's small for an office.
Very small.
Because inside, you know, a normal desk, a small desk, not an executive desk, is 30 by 60. Mm-hmm. That's 5 foot. And this is a 7 foot something interior. Also, for truck traffic or any kind of business, there's no toilet facilities included in this.
Yes.
What are these people going to do? Go to the restaurant next door? Or
no. The questions the two you just brought up were gone over very thoroughly in the zoning too, because a little building there is mainly for truckers to sign in and out. So there's a record of when they come in, when they're going out, and Ronald will, and I think your brothers, two of you are going to look into that. Go in there and check on it. They're not going to be there like all day long. Yeah. It's not like a place where you going to sit there and do work all day. It's more of a checking in to see who came in, who left, when did they leave.
I realize that, but I mean it's...
So in other words, they don't need a lot of special.
It's very nominal. It's very nominal. That's, that will fit in a small bedroom.
Yeah, we didn't want to do any more than we, add any more to this than we had to.
And what about the toilet facilities?
There are no toilet facilities.
I know that.
The people that will come in there live in the general proximity. They have houses there. That's my understanding, right, Ron? And we went over that too. The people that are parking here, the truckers, live nearby, most of them, right? Or if they don't, they have a car that they go to their, they're going to, that's why we have some car parking, so that they can drive to their house. Either walk or drive to their house.
They're going to run in that restaurant in emergency. I don't know if I was trucking, I have a condition, and I would just pull in there and maybe not even have time to back in, just pull it right in, and if I have an issue, I'd run over to the restaurant or the closest public facility that I might gain entrance to. I mean, it's a little ridiculous.
Yeah.
Actually, I think with the latest update in OSHA requirements, they at least require porta potties.
Yeah, something.
Because the latest update in OSHA requirements requires a porta potty for example, with the temporary construction now,
yeah.
It used to not be required, but anything that's over, any work thing that's over 2 days, I think it's now required.
That's correct.
So it might be an OSHA requirement now.
That's correct.
Although when you look around town and you see parking lots, I don't recall seeing any toilets there. Like just in general.
The parking garages all have public facilities.
Parking garage, yeah, I can see that.
Yeah, they do.
But those have to be shown on the plan, a porta potty. They wouldn't have to be shown on a plan, would they?
Might not, because it's not a permanent facility.
Permanent,
that's
right.
What I was thinking. Yeah. That may be a good idea, but
yeah. I would show a pad, concrete pad. So it's a dedicated use or
right.
Any structure.
So it might be in the best interest of the applicant to make sure that the OSHA requirements are met in this case. Like I said, these requirements are relatively new. For example, the truck parking lot at 11th and Richmond, mm-hmm. I don't think there's any facilities there, but that's been there for a long time. And of course, these things are not retroactive.
Are these trucks representative of one business owner or more than one?
More than one, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, Ron, but there's more than one business, correct? Owner, the trucks.
They are owner-operators.
There's more than one owner.
So it's...
I do have a question.
So it's not exactly a dedicated truck parking area for one company that has many trucks. It's not that.
No, I have an owner operator in my company.
Is it your company?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't have the right office because I need it. She's here with me.
I'm going to translate. He's worried about you guys are asking about all these requirements, but he's putting money into the property, but he don't know if he's going to be accepted as an applicant. You know, like the application is there, but is he going to be accepted or not? Because he's putting a lot of money. You're asking for a lot of requirement. You're like, we need this, we need that, but is he going to be accepted
That's the gamble you take when you come here.
That's right.
So you paid $1,000, and if we accept or not, that's, you know, your $1,000 is gone.
We are exercising, we are agents of the state, not the city. Planning Commission's answer to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, okay? And we have to go by the law, and we have to have certain requirements, so forth. So we're not asking these questions to be nasty. We are not making up these questions. there are things that we have to follow our guidelines as well as statutory laws. Statutory laws are written down, but we have to answer and all other issues. So that and all other issues is a lot of stuff.
I understand, but I also, and this is not me, I'm asking, because there is another parking lot, like a block away for another company, is the same thing, have more than 10 spaces there. And
that,
I think somebody
that,
has been...
That parcel is... That parcel is not compliant.
So it's going to be removed too?
So it's a long process. We've been fighting with them for 12 years. Okay. But that is a completely separate issue.
I understand that.
Okay. But if you, to clarify my statement, we have to follow what's called the subdivision and land development ordinance. It is section 500 of the ordinances of the city. It's I don't have a printout of it here. It's in my computer.
There are examples.
You know, it's about 80 pages of ordinances that we have to follow, and that's over and top of the 115 or 120 pages that is a zoning ordinance that you've already complied with. Okay, it's a separate set of rules and ordinances, and you have to prove that you're in compliance. Now luckily, since you already have the lighting plan done, that's something that we require. So that's already done for you guys. Landscaping plan, that's required by us. You furnished that already to the zoning hearing board. Okay, it's too bad that landscaping plan's not totally compliant. It was supposed to go to the arborist for review. We will make sure that it goes to the arborist for review like it normally does. These are easy fixes. Now, the OSHA ordinance, we have no overview of that, but that is something that falls in another department here in the city that could either fall under the health department or that could fall under the property maintenance division. It is in your best interest to look these things up beforehand, because for example, an OSHA fine is usually $125 a day for every day you're not in compliance. Okay. These are things that is your burden to look up first. We supply some guidance and try to give you guidance as to what might be the best way to resolve these problems. But, you know, it is up to you to eventually, because you can't come back to us and say, well, you shouldn't have granted it because we didn't meet the OSHA requirements. We can't enforce the OSHA requirements. That's another department.
Mr. Chairman, if I just may add.
Yes.
This is not like a hearing, like you were before zoning. This is not adversarial. This, what we're trying to do is examine this. You know, we could have gone with the recommendation and decided not to hear anything, but we are going through this with the idea that we expect that you'll probably modify this and come back, so we're trying to be helpful. It may not seem like it, but we, so far the only things we require really were for the city to do the research, and the only thing would be for to show the water, you know, the water main, whatever it was, I can't remember what it is, you know.
Yes, sewer lateral.
The sewer lateral on there, because we're not even sure about the, you know, we think the railroad right of way is not in here, so that's moot if that's the case. And it's more for the city to do, and then, as my colleague pointed out, sometimes what we do is we make you aware of some requirements, that we don't really have to do that, but we do that just to make it easier for you. That's what we were talking about with the restroom, you know, so that's all we're trying to do. We're very pro-business, and we're looking to see how we can come to a way to approve this, not to deny it, you know.
We appreciate that, but he's concerned about, you know, like, he wants to comply with everything, but he just want to make sure too that you guys are, you know, giving him the right guidance so he can comply with everything and he can get accepted, you know, because at the end, this man here, this business owner here, what he's trying to do is give work to other owner operators in Reading, and I include myself because I'm I have a business too, a trucking business too. So he's just trying to help other people and try to get business to, you know, work to other people here in Reading. So he's not even, he's not trying to do anything wrong. He's trying to comply so other people can, you know, at least have parking around. And I understand about safety issues and all that. And he is, you know, going to go on OSHA and find out about that part too, because, you know, I don't think he knew about it. So.
Yeah, no. And this is actually something that is very, that is needed in the city, because the city did try to enact an ordinance to limit the parking of tractor trailers around the city.
Streets.
On the streets. So, you know, a need, an important need is being fulfilled. Mm-hmm. But just because an important need is being fulfilled doesn't mean that you can just say that the ordinance doesn't mean anything.
No, he's not trying, you know, yeah. I mean, I don't think he's trying to do that. He's trying to comply.
Right.
But, you know, at the same time, he's worried about, you know, like, if he's going to be accepted.
Well,
because,
you know,
we comply with all this, and then can somebody say, no, we're not going to accept it because of this. You know, like, he just want to make sure that he's guided.
That's
right.
Well, that's why this is normally a 90-day process. Mm-hmm. This is not a once and done thing. This is not one meeting and then we're done. Because this is submitted as a preliminary plan, correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So actually, it could, depending on how things work out, it could be 180 days before it gets approved. Mm-hmm. Now, usually we don't take that long. But, you know, do understand that we do have 90 days to review the preliminary plan, and then we have another 90 days to review the final plan.
The reference you made to others who may not, okay, that's called, well, it's called several things. There's a condition called prior existing conditions. Now, that is, use a nickname, the grandfather clause, where someone was in business for 30 years, 20 years, and what they were doing at that time when they started their business was legal. But laws changed, and two things happen after laws change. Either the old businesses have to comply with the new laws, or if there's no caveat, if there's no little piece of that law that says, we all have to comply with that beginning tomorrow morning, then they don't have to comply, and it's called pre-existing conditions, it's grandfathers, it's let it alone. But from tomorrow on, all new situations like that in business have to comply with the law. But there are different laws that have different stipulations on that. And then we have, well, in Reading as well as everywhere else, businesses that fail to comply with a regulation that they're supposed to follow. They're obligated to do that. And it's in contempt of the law. They say, yeah, well, there's a law, but I don't bother. I'll wait till they come and get me. Well, there's action that municipalities can take against those people, such as putting a lien, L-E-I-N, on their property. And that's fine. You do your thing. You just disobey the law. You just go on your merry way. However, 10 years from now, when you go to sell that property, the court is going to say, we take the money that you just sold the property for because you owe X amount of money on a lien that was placed on you by the IRS or the borough of Shillington or somebody. Then folks get excited. So I don't, he doesn't know all of the regulations. The rules, the things that zoning look at are incomplete. And what we look at in planning, I also think that many times we're incomplete too. But the two groups don't have the same regulations. Now, another thing that has happened, zoning, you have approval, planning in city, you have approval. This goes to county planners when we're done. And the county sometimes objects to something that the other two bodies have approved. And say, well, why didn't you tell us that ahead of time? Well, we can't because we know most of the things that they'll look at or will be looking at. But every now and then, they look at something that we missed that they feel is applicable, and they also follow state Commonwealth rules and regulations. They might interpret something totally different. So we don't always know what they're doing until after they've done it. Now, I don't want to paint a black picture for you, but this is reality. This has happened. Is he in business now? Is he in business now? In business? Yes. See. Okay. Where are you parking your trucks or your independent truckers? Where are they parking?
And 1724.
That property.
Yeah.
Without permission, no permiso. You can't do that.
No. They gave him permission.
From who? Whom?
Right there.
Who?
Yeah, I was wondering that, Mr. Chairman. Who? Because I've been saying for several, many months now, the truck's parking there.
Vicky Hoffman.
Who?
Vicky Hoffman.
Who is Vicky Hoffman? Help me with that.
That's the zoning officer, Mr. Chairman. So again, trying to explain that there are two different processes here. You went through zoning. Now you're at the Planning Commission, and you don't have full approval from this body. So what should have happened is that you would have gotten zoning approval and then getting Planning Commission approval, then you would commence your business. So that's only one part, as it's been said already. Zoning is just one part of your process. So just because zoning gave you approval doesn't mean you can start the business. You don't have planning approval yet. Okay?
I have a question, Mr. Chair. Question. Couldn't this have been submitted just as a parking lot plan? Isn't that how our saldo, in other words, a preliminary? I mean, for parking lot, we don't have preliminary and final, do we? Don't we just have parking lot plan? I'm trying to remember. Usually they're pretty simple. That's why I was a little confused, because there's a building going on. Is this something more than a parking lot?
It's a use. Because they have the office, it's a use.
Yes.
And that's why we are here. It's a saldo application for a use, including the parking, which needs the requirements of saldo.
Right, but I mean, could it have been a parking lot plan?
Yeah, well...
Or is it preliminary? Does it matter? I don't know if it matters.
If you remove the office, it would be only a parking lot, but it's more than
that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, thank you.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Because of that structure on there, why we're not doing it just as a parking lot.
Thank you.
That's what I thought. Right. Yeah. Okay. Appreciate that.
So that means if he removes the office, then he'll be able to...
No, sorry, that's not what I meant.
Category. Well, you're getting into something... Yeah. It's a different category, so you have to consider that, consider the ramifications of removing the office if you're going to do that.
Right. But it's still more than 10 parking spaces, so it still requires a land development plan.
Right. It's just a different category.
Yeah, it's just a different...
There's a different fee, too, for... But you've already paid the fee for a preliminary plan anyway, so... And we're here now, so...
Right.
Which is okay. You know, we're not saying you have to remove the shed. It's just, I was... That's what I thought. I just wanted to be sure as to why it was simply a parking lot. Because normally, we only just have a parking lot plan, unless it's a garage, you know. It's just a parking lot. Maybe, of course, it'd have landscaping and so forth, but no structures.
Like the proposed parking lot at Sixth and Spring, that was just a parking lot plan because there were no structures on it.
Right.
But...
Okay.
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
But basically, the fees and the process are almost the same.
Okay.
So, you know, the office doesn't make that much of a difference. No matter what, you would have come to us anyway.
Well, we've taken Mr. Hunter's recommendation as a motion. We will make the motion that we don't consider for a preliminary plan a denial or approval. Is that the consensus?
So.
And that we let it, he has additional time to get some of these issues remediated?
Well, we need to table the plan anyway because we don't have planning, we don't have county planning commission comments that were required by the MPC anyway.
But Mr. Chairman, didn't we want to discuss, because the recommendation is about the truck route. I know that's a concern that we have. So
yeah, I was wondering.
I know you wanted to bring it up. Our colleague wanted to bring it up.
I was wondering, is that truck route what was proposed at the zoning hearing board?
Yes.
Okay. All right. That truck route makes no sense. Because you would want to make sure that if you had a truck route, for these type of vehicles, that they are not going through residential areas. Turns out that there's an easy truck route that goes through the manufacturing commercial district, and you would have no, and it takes you right to Route 12. And that would be to, go east on Burn Street to North 11th and make a left-hand turn. That keeps all the trucks in the manufacturing commercial district.
East on Burn Street?
Yeah, going to Albury.
Mr. Bueller, Mr. Thomas has a question.
That's off the site completely, Burn Street. Well, you mean... Yeah, that's the way they're going right now. They're going in and out of this which is...
Well, it seems that the zoning hearing board testimony says that they go out 10th Street onto Exeter.
Excuse me. Mr. Bueller, the map that I showed was to make sure that was not how they were going.
If
they move through that area down 10th to Exeter, then that's where we were going to be having an issue because it was going through residential housing. So we wanted to make sure that the board was aware that's not a route that we approve of.
Yeah, exactly. And we do have agreements with other businesses. Mm-hmm. I understand that Evergreen Community Power has shut down, but the city does have an agreement with them that they can only use one truck route. That was pre-approved.
Yeah, that was, Mr. Chairman, my concern, because, you know, I live not too far from this neighborhood, that there is a need for this. We had many trucks that were parked on the street. The city's done a good job on enforcement. Ever since the Rockland, remember I brought this up, ever since the Rockland student housing building was built, all the trucks that were parked on Richmond Street in particular and in this area are, generally speaking, not parked there, at least not overnight. There's an exception a little bit further away, nothing to do with this, on North 13th Street, by the way, which I can talk to you about later. But other than that, it's been very good getting these off of the street. It makes it a lot easier for, you know, visibility and so forth. and convenience for people. So there definitely is the need for something like this, and my only concern was about the routing of the trucks in the residential, and it's very high traffic. It's a very busy intersection. So the one down at Kutztown Road and Exeter, Exeter Streets and 10th, and well, it's all those streets that come together there, not 10th, 9th Street, and Moss comes in here too. Mm-hmm. So it's a four-way intersection, but it's very busy. So so those concerns are appreciated, and if the applicant is willing to declare or whatever, or you know, and accept the requirement of that truck route, as my colleague just mentioned, and then I would have no objection. You know,
basically coming in from Burn Street and going out to Burn Street. Not turning down 10.
That's correct. Okay. Yeah, using Burn Street to 11, because that
anyway.
Yeah, that contains the trucks within the manufacturing commercial district where. You know, where the trucks are generally allowed, without question.
So now, Wayne, so your recommendation is, as you put out to all of us, this would be the preferred route that we think meets all the requirements for truck circulation to and from the main thoroughfare of being West Warren Street bypass to use North 11th and come in and out of Burn.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Great.
Thank you. And this, to add, this there is no pedestrian traffic here on 10th and Burn. And I mean, I didn't even know this street connected until we did the BARDA plan, you know, several months ago, that there's even an intersection here, because there's no need to go there. You know, I know it came up with the Magisterial Justice proposed office, so there's minimal. There's minimal, not only pedestrian, but even civilian, you know, vehicular traffic going that way. So that would really be minimal, and as my colleague said, it's within the manufacturing zone, so it would pose no problem. It might cut out some of the truck traffic that there is currently. I don't know. So that I think that would satisfy our concern.
I think we just maybe the thought was. Because we showed the truck here on 10th Street going in, maybe you were thinking that's the way they're coming in. But I think that was just shown there to show that a truck could make the turn. That was all.
Oh, yeah.
We should have just shown it straight, I guess.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Not even showed that.
Yeah. But that's not a problem, because you do need to show all the truck turning radiuses and all that stuff anyway on the plan. So luckily. You know, as I mentioned, a lot of things that the zoning hearing board required of you, you're already done for us.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. So you're not doing this stuff twice. Because that I took a quick look at the lighting plan. That looked fine.
Okay.
Adam might have to take a look at it. Oh, the other question I had is, what is, I always forget because they changed the ordinance. Used to be that a parking lot had to be macadam. Hmm. And I don't know what the requirements are anymore.
It reads, I don't know word for word, but it also says, unless you could show that it's adequate, something of that nature. I don't know the exact wording, but you use an asphalt or concrete, or show that what's there is going to be adequate, I think.
Typically, Public Works chimes in on that unless planning wants to do that. It's a zoning requirement, but Public Works oversees that. What it says is that it's in the zoning that any paved surfaces or parking or driveways cannot be gravel. It has to be an all-weather resistant surface, which usually means asphalt or concrete, typically. Now, you can get some fancy engineered materials that we can take a look at, and we've seen some of those more or less unusual special circumstance, but typically it's going to be, and for this use I would expect to see something like concrete or asphalt.
So this is asphalt as it is, the existing condition is asphalt with some broken pieces of asphalt, and, you know, broken up here and there, chips and so on.
We're going to have
primarily asphalt.
You think we'd have to address and comply with MS4?
Well, that's another big question.
Yeah.
That's another big question.
Let's get through this one first, and then we can talk about stormwater.
Oh, you're going to talk about that before?
Okay. Yeah. So we have to determine whether or not this is going to be resurfaced, and the amount of resurfacing plays into the next thing, which is the stormwater management, which we haven't really talked about, but we have talked about it.
Did you see my narrative that I wrote?
I did.
The real simple.
I just...
I have, I'll give you a copy. Basically, the water's draining.
What it boils down to, though, is when you determine what needs to be all-weather, permanent all-weather surface, so it doesn't erode and shed material off-site onto a neighbor or into the street and into our storm sewers, okay, that's what we're trying to prevent. Then we can work on the stormwater management, and that's something that gets a little deep for this meeting in this body, and I would recommend
Yeah. That's,
we get together and talk about that.
That's also another thing about here in the city that seems to be overlooked by many of the engineering firms, is that our MS4 requirements here in the city are different than everywhere else in Berks County, pretty much.
Each one.
Yeah, and so we have a different set, and that's why Public Works is so important to get their feedback, because I actually read the stormwater management narrative that you wrote, and it's a good start, but it's going to need a lot more.
The reason I made MS4, it's so simple, is that I was considering essentially no real change in the lot, mm-hmm. so that we're not increasing the runoff. We're not adding, except for that little, well, you might even say that isn't even a little building doesn't amount to anything, because if it's asphalt, it's impervious anyway. We could go out and look at it, Tim. Look at the parking lot.
The one item that I would bring up for this body, without getting into the weeds of stormwater management, is the drainage plan exception. And I asked if you would look into the calculations. And do you think that the net new impervious that you're proposing would meet the quality? I haven't looked at it. So if you've looked at it, do you believe that would meet the exception requirements, and thereby meaning that you don't need to submit a drainage plan, which basically means you don't have to put in the detention pond.
Right. What we're proposing now, I think, yeah.
Okay. It would meet it. And then what we would look for is in a letter, draft that as a request for that, because this body has to approve that.
For the stormwater exemption.
Yeah, because we would have to do a waiver for that.
An exception.
Right. Exception, yeah.
Also, are any traps involved in this, like oil, antifreeze, diesel traps?
I'll take a look at it, but normally parking lot, no. We didn't do it for the bus depot across the street or any of the other parking lots. I have to look and see. I don't think it's considered a hotspot. Unless, are you doing maintenance at all?
No. No maintenance.
Okay.
That's one thing they will make sure of there at the zoning.
Okay.
Nothing ringing a bell on as far as traps.
Mr. Chairman, when we review a preliminary plan, should there not be preliminary calculations in stormwater management? Because we're looking at a 1.38-acre site, and it's 90% impervious. And I see nothing in these documents that show me any way that there's stormwater management. Do we require a preliminary review, or is that what you have?
That's what we were commenting on that, and okay. I had talked with Ed. He said that he submitted a narrative, although you're correct, there's nothing on the plan that demonstrates where stormwater DMTs would be in place. And I think you're going to, even though you get, if you get an exception for a drainage plan, you still have to comply with with the three requirements for groundwater infiltration, for water quality, and for stream bank protection. And that's something we see.
I did read through that. If it's at 505 something, it is, right?
That's the stormwater.
Yeah, that's what I was looking at.
Because it looks going from southwest to northeast, there's a 7-foot drop in sight.
Mm-hmm. Pretty flat out there, yeah.
And
pretty flat. I've got the grades on one of my worksheets over there.
Sheet 3 of 6, it shows existing conditions.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So basically, existing conditions are, in terms of grading and stormwater flow, and you'll see the slopes on there, 1.5, 2%, real flat, 3% over here in the corner. But so we're not proposing any grading activity at all, no earthwork.
So the site's going to be...
Except for planting the trees and the shrubs.
The site's going to be self-contained?
No, basically, this is the existing condition is proposed condition in terms of runoff. That's what I'm getting at. So the impervious, the runoff coefficient of 90% or 95% remains the same. We're not adding any additional impervious. Again, you could go out and look at the, Tim, you could go out with me and look at the, the surface and see if you agree. Some people say, well, we ought to use 80% because there's some, instead of 95% and compare existing as 80% versus 95 for new paving, something of that nature. You know?
I haven't seen it in a while since the DJ's office.
Right.
I don't remember it being totally paved out there.
I don't believe it is.
There's remnants of paving that isn't
like... Right. Remnants, but not like a paved...
Flat, not right. Flat, not necessarily a very flat
just
surface.
Just a paved surface. I think there are areas of abandoned rubble and other things like that around the site.
It looks like
I don't think you're
small pieces of asphalt.
Well, I think even bigger than that, too. I think there's remnants of old buildings and things or whatever pad foundation.
No. Yeah. You can drive all over the site, I believe, right, Ronald?
It's made.
You can?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, there's no big hunks of concrete sticking out of the ground.
The only thing we need to look for to see is it all weather? Does it meet that zoning mark, or is it all weather resistant surface? And then move from there. If it isn't, what are you going to be paving? And what you're going to be paving may come into the calculation, assuming it comes into the calculation for stormwater infiltration. And typically, it's not huge, but it is MS4. And MS4 is going to be important when it comes to I'm saying that because we've seen other parking lots. This commission has seen others, and we've been through the drill before. I mean, this is typically what happens. It's not the city trying to be hard on you. In fact, we're going to try to make it as easy as you can, but you need to comply because the city has to comply with the MS4 requirements.
And just so the applicant knows, we're talking about MS4. I forget what it means. But that is a federal ordinance that we have to follow. So, you know, it's not like we made it up. It's something we have to follow because the federal government in Washington, D.C. says we have to follow it. So these are the layers of ordinances that we try to sort out and make it as easy as possible. To get through this process, because this gets pretty technical. As you can hear us talking back and forth, we're talking some pretty technical stuff.
Mm-hmm. I'm explaining something.
Okay.
That's all I have.
Just a few housekeeping things. I'm not sure to what degree there's a sidewalk here on the 10th Street side, but I think we waived it for Bardo across the street because of what I said earlier, so I don't know if that's going to come up. Like, I'm not sure. I didn't really look at the satellite on that, and obviously never go there.
In 2014, we actually just asked for sidewalk to the entrance on 10th Street. But there's only going to be an emergency entrance now on 10th Street. So actually, we could probably waive the sidewalk.
That's what I was getting at. So we would consider that depending on how it figures.
Yeah, because really nobody's going to be walking here.
Nobody's walking. Not that we could encourage people to walk there anyway.
We could make the requirement of the sidewalk to this emergency access in case there are neighbors, people in the neighborhood, because there is a sidewalk there on the west side of 10th Street. Mm-hmm. And like I said, we just asked the county to just put in that 15 feet or sidewalk or whatever it was, so that you could get to the driveway entrance and then walk in. But generally, I would see no...
I mean, is there currently an apron there where this emergency access is proposed?
It's hard to tell. Existing condition plan, see.
Yeah, there's a partial paper there that says concrete.
Yeah, that's what it looks, but I don't know if that's, you know, I'm looking at the legend, I wasn't sure if that's what it meant, so, okay. If that's proposed or existing, or, okay.
That's existing.
Okay.
Are you proposing to modify?
Yeah, I was going to say, because it doesn't look wide enough for a truck. I don't know, maybe it is, I don't know.
Well, I don't remember exactly.
The existing concrete that's shown there doesn't look wide enough.
No.
There is a 20-foot wide emergency access.
Yeah.
Proposed there, and the existing concrete isn't that wide.
That looks like only half.
Is that on your list?
What's that?
The width of the driveway for zoning? We've got the two aprons, the two driveway approaches.
No, that was not on my list, I missed that.
Okay.
I had seen that, I think, with the ZHB or prior, or with my predecessor's notes to I think, Ludwig.
Was it mentioned in the decision at all? Was that ever brought up in the decision?
As far as this emergency access?
As far as the driveway entrances at all, either one.
Yeah, 33 feet's not allowed, is it?
I think it's 20, if you want to go wider.
They looked at this in detail, and they approved it. No, I didn't remember any specific comments saying that should only be, you're only allowed 20 feet, and you're only allowed. Burn Street's a dead end there. Just, there's nothing, you can drive over the railroad tracks.
Yeah, that I checked.
What's that?
You can't drive over the railroad tracks.
What I'm saying is, that's what you'd have to do if you want to go further.
I did not check that. I saw previous notes from my predecessor, but I don't think I included those in my report.
I don't disagree with you. And I don't want to, this sort of gets in between planning and public works. I don't want to object to 33 feet, but if the zoning ordinance, or the saldo, I forget which one it's in, says 20 is the maximum, then I can
Okay. We'll address that. We'll check that.
That is something that you should address and comment on if you're looking for a waiver. That is something you need to do.
And then there was something in the comments, I don't remember the specifics, but I think all three things were mentioned. The datum, the plan size, sheet size, and the scale. We've typically been waiving those requirements, so that'll make it easier for you.
I mean, easy enough to get.
Yeah, we've been going with the industry standard. In fact, we've proposed to modify all those. I know Public Works and was working on their part, and we were working on ours to propose some amendments to the ordinance so that we won't have to go through this every time, make it easier for the applicants. But until we get to that point, we have enough administrative things to catch up on. We'll have to consider waiving that, and I can't presume how we would vote, but typically that's what we've been granting, so that shouldn't be a problem.
See, the size of the plates was recommended by the county planning, mm-hmm. so that we would be in concert with their requirements, because the same plans are going to both bodies, and they don't want to work on, make sense, who wants to work with different scales? So they had made some recommendations as far as the scales, mm-hmm. universal, as far as the fee schedule in the county, universal, for all planning bodies, and be in concert with what the county's services were doing. So that's where that's coming from. All right, folks, have we covered everything? Have you understand us? Comprende todos? Todo va bien? Todo va bien.
I just have one question. Is it Adam? Is that right? Adam,
yes.
Your name? And you're new here, right?
Correct.
Adam Thomas?
Yes.
Okay. So you're, are we going to get a letter from you or something? That
we will send you notes on the items that will need to be addressed in this meeting tonight. Correct.
I mean, I wrote some down here, but I hope I don't miss anything. But you were saying you didn't want to review the plan now, or you think we shouldn't even review it at all? Is that what you people, is that what you're thinking?
As long as we can have an agreement on that the truck traffic moves through the manufacturing commercial district, I think we should be okay, because there are existing commercial uses in that area. We just don't want the truck straying
you know, onto Exeter Street and going up through the college and all that stuff.
Because it's too small for them to drive around, so they don't want to do that. They really want to go to, you know, better, the best route.
Right, and, you know, I figure, you know, making that left onto 11th, they can get right onto Route 12, you know, and then if they can go where they need to go. See, we had that, when the bottling plant was proposed, we had a lot of issues about the truck traffic on Schuylkill Avenue. See, and you don't even have that, as long as, you know, you keep to that 11th Street, that 11th Street corridor. So, you know, as long as we can have a note on the plan for that, I don't even think we need a full-blown agreement like we did for Evergreen, because Evergreen actually went through and did a traffic study and all of that.
I'm remembering too, and I don't remember if it was when I was here or before, something about Laurel, Fifth Street from Laurel on down about truck traffic. Something came up on a plan too.
Right.
Was that
right.
An Evergreen?
Yeah, and that's, you know, all truck traffic has to go on Canal Street.
Right. But yeah, that goes by about half a dozen houses. Was there?
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's why we had that agreement with Evergreen that they had to go
from
Canal Street to, I think that's Pine Street, and then onto the Binghamton Street Bridge. They could only use that.
Right.
And
that's the one.
And okay. Yeah, and they paid something like $10,000 for a traffic study.
Okay.
To prove all that. But Bogia did the traffic study. So, the only question I have that Public Works might have to take a look at is with increased truck traffic coming up Burn Street, making a left onto 11th, is there going to be a stop sign, a four-way stop sign?
I'd have to totally take a look at it. It would have to be warranted. In other words, if a stop sign would be something the city would like, or something that the applicant would like, it would have to be an traffic engineering study to warrant the addition of a stop sign. That's how we do all stop signs in the city. We just don't throw them in the ground. We get engineered. And I'm not a traffic engineer. We don't have any traffic engineers on staff. So that would have to be borne by the applicant to do that. And I can't answer the question whether Public Works or the city would be to the best interest of the city to put them in the
right
sign. They would have to be proven out by the traffic volumes.
Yeah. Well, maybe, you know, since I forget how many truck spots there are, but you know, it might be low enough where it doesn't matter. It's just that, like, at certain times, like at what, like between 3 and 4 in the afternoon, you know, you have traffic all the way from Rockland all the way back to Exeter.
Yeah, especially so. My driver leaving about 2 or 3 in the morning, come back 5 or 6 p.m. You know, in long, a approach hour time.
Yeah, and luckily coming back, that's a right hand turn.
Yeah.
So that's not quite so bad either. It's just I'm just concerned about
getting out and making the left, making it
safe for your drivers and your safe for everybody. But if, you know, most of them are 2-3 in the morning. Yeah, 11th Street doesn't use that heavily.
is there westbound on Burn? Is there like a, you know, you might not know, because I've never been on that intersection, 10th and Burn. Is there a no outlet sign or something, or is that, you know?
I don't know.
Because, you know, the road terminates before it gets to the road.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's any sign because the stub's so small.
Yeah.
The stub's pretty small. The stub's only 20 feet long before it hits the railroad track.
Yeah, maybe a little longer than that.
Oh, don't go by the map.
No, okay.
By the map in the top right hand corner. That is incorrect.
Yeah, you can't turn around. So
yeah.
So
yeah, the what's shown on this Microsoft map is actually incorrect.
Okay.
That is not actually what the conditions are.
Okay.
It's about 100 and some feet.
So,
if I may recommend, Ed, if you would meet, you mentioned about getting comments as far as the Public Works. there's a lot of stuff that needs to be put on the plan. So rather than me come up with comment based on this plan,
right.
I would recommend it, if you're anticipating submitting, resubmitting for next month, have a meeting with me. Perhaps Adam can join us, or David, and we could go over this in detail. Then you can modify your drawing. Then we could do a real review, real preliminary plan review, and get you good comments.
Okay,
maybe
good.
Some of this stuff would just go away because you trust them.
When can we do that?
And you want to do it pretty quick because the due date for November
is November 7th?
First week of November. I think it's three weeks now, isn't it?
First week of November, we need to submit the plans.
Yeah, you need to submit it. So you want to meet with us beforehand so you can modify the drawings.
That might even be a little short for them.
That would be quick.
Yeah.
I think December would be more cushion.
I'm just saying. Well, we got a lot of work to do here.
Could we possibly do that next, well, maybe this week yet or next week?
I am open Friday. I don't know about planning.
I would have to check my schedule.
Yeah.
Okay. Can I get your name?
Oh, my name's Wayne.
Wayne. Okay. Because I don't have.
Beeler. B-E-A-L-E-R.
And who's the chairman?
That is Ermedi over there.
Your name, sir?
E-R-M-E-T-E. R-A-F-F. A-E-L-L-I.
Okay. So chairman. And the first man there, what's your name, please?
William Sinfisi. All our names are on the, you know, Mr. Olson's is on, are on the website.
Okay, so on the website?
Easier for you.
I know, people have been changing a lot, so good enough.
Yeah. Well, Ermedi's been here 30 years. I've been here 15.
Okay.
4 years.
Will's here's been here four.
Sorry, darn it, yeah.
I know it's done. You can get over here that much.
15 years.
Actually, I believe this is the first time that you've represented Ludgate here.
I rarely.
Usually it's Tom.
Yeah. Or Matt.
Matt.
Yeah.
Matt's been.
What's that term we used to use?
Which,
just made an evaluation.
Yeah. So,
it was before preliminary.
Thank you very much. Because that was a lot to go over, a lot more than you probably realized because of the ordinances we have to follow.
So I think maybe the next step would be for you to meet with Tim and Adam, right?
Yeah. I think that would be the best thing. Yeah.
Mr. Beeler, Mr. Adam, I'm going to make a recommendation, and we can do this, that we rename this presentation a sketch plan, and then that will open the window for us for the next one, which would be a preliminary, and that give you the 90-day window that commences on that date. And I also would think that we could extend this window to December. I mean, that because you don't want to push it, you don't want to jam yourself up. If you need the time, you have it. If you can make it by the November deadline for this meeting, that's fine. But if you can't, it gives you to December for your presentation of your preliminary plan. Then you don't have to come back to us and everybody's running around with a headache.
Hmm? Unless there's some way we could do what they call a preliminary / final, so you can do that.
Well, that could be then. But we're looking at the 90-day clock, because otherwise, then you have to ask for an extension, and then we'll give it to you. And it could be 30, 60, or 90 day. We usually recommend we give you another 90. If you're ready to go in 30, that's fine.
And there's no cost for anything.
Yeah, no question. There's no added cost for anything. But if some people ask for, I can get it done in 30, then they get jammed up. Then they need another 30 or 60. So we give you the, you see? So that's what the recommendation I'm going to ask from the committee to make. What do you think, Mr. Beeler?
I have no objection to that, because I believe that the applicant did not realize all of the things that need to be covered, especially with the stormwater management and a few other things.
Luckily, we can help out a little bit, because we did take a look at this, and the previous engineering firm, you know, pointed out a lot of these things in the past, so that we can give a heads up as to what the existing problems are on this site.
Well, are we agreement? Someone wish to make a motion?
Yeah, what would the motion be, and would that be in order to do it? What do you recommend?
Do you agree with this?
Absolutely. Yes, we're okay. We're deferring the decision until November, and this is a sketch plan review, correct?
Yes, this is a sketch in November, or if you ask December, you want your preliminary plan.
Yeah, and then we'll start the clock when they submit their preliminary plan.
Yeah.
And the fee for a sketch, that's $1,000 also, is that, or is it less than that?
So.
No, that's included. That's not a separate fee, is it?
Yeah, there's a fee for a sketch plan.
But they've already paid.
They've paid for the full plan, so.
Yeah.
Do we have to refund?
We can apply it to the sketch plan.
No, because if you have a sketch, you have to have a preliminary and a final plan anyway.
Anyway, yeah.
So I.
Right.
They paid.
Give them a credit, is like what Mr. Hart said, yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good idea.
Yeah, I have, yeah.
I don't know.
So do you wish to verbalize the intent?
I make a motion that, yeah, I make a motion that we accept today's submittal as a sketch plan rather than a preliminary plan. And we will therefore, on the next submission, accept their preliminary plan.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 We are unanimous. Aye. See, we're not hard to get along with.
That makes sense.
And if you need help, contact this man. Okay? You have his number? You have everything? Okay.
Those will be.
And he'll help you.
Yep, we have a great professional staff in place now that that can really help with these help the applicants, and of course Tim's always been on board getting these things completed, so there should be no problem with this moving forward.
Put that over up to the applicant.
Yes.
Okay. All right, we're going to other businesses. Anyone need 5 minutes for a break or anything? Everybody good? All right.
We haven't had a plan for so long.
Yeah. All right, we're going to move on, folks. Excuse me. The report from the liaison for the commission. That is Mr. Simplici. No, Mr. Beeler.
Yeah, that's it.
Yes.
Do you want to thank you for the opportunity, and you want to comply with everything so the RFP goes the right way?
Thank you. Good luck.
Yeah, good luck, but I'm sure you'll be able to work through the process. Because you've already done a lot of the hard work. Like I said, the landscaping plan, you know, is here. The lighting plans are already here. A lot of the hard work's already done.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good night. All right. Where are we at here? Again. Mr. Beeler.
Yeah.
You have a report.
Yes. I had the great opportunity to have a meeting with David and Adam last week, I believe it was. And we discussed
we discussed an overview of some of the things that we're used to, but also things like the comprehensive plan, the annual reports, and things of that nature, so that we can get the planning department in compliance with the reporting statutes. So we will be working on that over time, since I'm the point person on that. So
this has been an anomaly where for 3 months and just having one agenda item. I mean, I'm only 30 years and I don't remember this at all. I remember we would cancel one meeting maybe in 3 years, and it was usually because of snow or ice.
Yeah.
Maybe in 10 years, maybe twice because we didn't have anything on the agenda. But this hiatus of 3 months with only this item, I've never experienced this. And I would be a little suspicious if there might be a few projects that should have come to our attention and didn't. Where some people were attempting to take a slide because they knew that we were at one point unstaffed, not short staffed. And there was no one practicing due diligence.
Oh, which?
I'm sorry, I didn't want to cut you off.
Yeah, no, you know me, when the stuff pops into my head. Talking about compliance, a company was putting a DAS system on top of the monopole at George Field today.
Oh, today.
I'm not sure that monopole now meets the height requirements. They put a huge thing on top of that pole.
An extension.
Yeah, with a DAS system. It now looks like a dead deer on top of there with antlers. I am not kidding.
Is it supposed to?
No, we have to lift it.
Well, the DAS systems have all these multiple antennas.
No, some of them are, we have one that's going to look like a pine tree. That's proposed next to Hamden Barn.
Yeah. So, so now I'm not even sure if that meets the height requirements now, or does that pole now meet the ordinance with this big, huge monstrosity on top of it?
While we're on that, my mind skips around to different things. Let me bring up this issue. Do you recall the storage facility that we approved over the 18th Ward off of back at Kenhorst Boulevard where the Crescent Brass was Angelica. Before that it was the Oak Brook Elementary School.
Angelica's
storage. Remember that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, they're okay. They're mm-hmm. doing their things mm-hmm. and I think they might be making a change because they're having a little difficulty renting the large building. But aside from that, they're okay. Their next door neighbor, we brought up the fact that had changed from there was a concrete company there, stone concrete with the mixers going out, and it was converted into this storage facility with the little storage garages and so forth, and no one has been able to find paperwork on that. There were a lot of changes made there, areas that were, part of that was unpaved, because I remember I used to go in there. And there were a lot of changes made, but it never went through this body at all. And there was some question about that, and that's the time that some of our people started to leave. So I guess I'm asking the staff to investigate that. I don't even remember the name of it.
Yeah, I'll see it
when I go to the bank.
Run over there.
Because it's in front of me next to the car wash. But it was quite substantial what they did with that property. I don't think anything went through City Hall.
Yeah, that's...
This is not the Angelica storage. Right. This is something else.
Yeah, this is something else. This is New Holland.
Oh, it's on New Holland.
Yeah.
I was thinking of this earlier when you talked about non-compliant.
If you're in back of the bank, that's on Lancaster Avenue in the parking lot there, and Dunkin' Donuts, look directly across the street, they're open 24/7.
Yeah, oil change.
So, It's, that was brought to our attention on that other investigation.
Right. Yeah, and that's something that was never followed up on because of the change in staff.
No. But that looks like one of these. It's been there a while. It's been there a few years, but it never came through here because I wouldn't recall that one because that's in my backyard.
Yeah.
And nothing. Okay. Anything else for a liaison's report? You okay?
Nope. Yeah, just wanted to mention that we did have a meeting and it went very well. And then I forget the materials that I sent to Adam, but there was a question about something, so I sent him a bunch of materials and I showed him the stages that Andrew used to do, and that as to, you know, what we're familiar with, how things run. And Adam seemed to have followed everything beautifully, because the staff comments, you know, are very much like what we're used to in the past.
And Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to express my gratitude that we have Mr. Hunter and Mr. Thomas hired by the city. We were ably served by first the County Planning Commission filling in, and then by the zoning administrator, Mr. Zahner, doubling as the planner, and having their input is already just on this one plan from the emails, the discussion beforehand, and their input tonight already is very helpful, and very glad to have them and looking forward to working with them and addressing all this backlog of administrative things that they'll have to deal with, as we'll get into shortly. So welcome and thank you both.
Thank you.
All right, let's go on to blighted property review. Bill, do you have any?
Yes, on Thursday we held our certification hearing, and we certified 18 properties as blighted. Now the other item of business is I've served on this as the representative of the Planning Commission on that body. I think it's about 2 years now, in relief of Commissioner Beeler. And Commissioner Olson had served on that body from, I believe, its inception, was it about 2007, is that right? Mm-hmm. And I believe he was chairing it the whole time I was there, and if not from the beginning, right?
Yeah, exactly.
From the beginning. And there's a rule the city has that a member may only be, other than when there's an exception like this where one body's represented one another, that a person may not be a member of more than one board, commission, or authority at the same time, even though these are all volunteer posts. It's in the charter. So as a result, I discussed this with Commissioner Olson, and I offered so that he could stay on the blighted property, that I would resign as the Planning Commission's representative, and allow for the opportunity for our new colleague to be appointed in my stead. And that would be my recommendation, Mr. Chairman. It was a pleasure serving on the Blighted Property Commission. There's a good group there of volunteers very much concerned about making the city more livable and a better place, and in compliance with our comprehensive plan, what will be the comprehensive plan, and about the city's housing policy. And you know, I miss working with them all, but the experience that Commissioner Olson has is far more than I do. So I would tender my resignation at this point and ask for its acceptance, and recommend the appointment of Commissioner Olson as our representative on the Blighted Property Review Committee.
I'll make a motion to accept Mr. Simfisi's resignation as the Planning Commission representative on the Blighted Property Review Committee, and recommend that Commissioner Olson now become the Planning Commission representative to the Blighted Property Review Committee.
Second.
That motion includes the acceptance by Mr. Olson, that's a tricky motion. Maybe you should ask Mr. Olson if he wishes to serve also on that capacity.
I'll second the motion first.
Second
the motion, so then we can discuss it.
What did you second?
Whatever he just said.
You expect him to remember that?
I accept.
He accepts, good. Question and a motion. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? You're unanimous.
Excellent.
Okay. Other business. Review of any draft meeting minutes. Well, we have a time for...
Yeah. Hopefully next month. We'll get to that.
No, I'm thinking about 4 months.
I didn't want to bury Adam in stuff.
Thank you.
I want to bring up these three things, and I will be short on them. The comprehensive plan issue was discussed several times, I believe, between us, one-on-one or whatever, with Mr. Hunter. And we've arrived at, I think, we know what we wish to do with that. And we did have a comprehensive plan that was worked on for 10 months. And then we sort of decided that it wasn't as complete as it should be and didn't meet all needs, so we decided to look at a new attempt, and that's generally where we are now. Mr. Hunter has got to look at that and funding and so forth, and we'll let the other one die. 14th Street Pool, the city, did they vote? They took the vote to buy that property. All right, this, I wanted to get this to them before, but Mr. Kroll will. That's a private organization. They owe the city money. They owe us water, sewer, possibly taxes on part of the property, and it extends way down the street almost to Walnut to that housing development that was put in. I don't know if the pool purchase would include that land, but they should play some kind of let's make a deal, have some kind of abatement on what they owe in exchange for getting that whole strip of land, because that's the barrier between where our housing stops and the conservancy of the mountain begins. And that strip of land that's owned in there is owned by the pool co-op or organization, whatever, the association, whatever they call it. The third thing is something that came
just
up
respond
with...
To that. It's probably something legal, not Public Works, would look into when they do the transaction. Before they take title to it, I would imagine they would have to clear it with their money. Taxes, well, any liens, any...
Well, I'm saying they should look into it and do something.
Legal would be doing that.
Because we don't want to consider, again, something that came up and didn't even get through zoning and go through all of that again. Because that's the second project, I think, that failed for one reason or another on that site. And the third thing... this gentleman here that was just with us is trying to do the right thing. However, he's in business there how long without approval from this body and maybe some other bodies? 6 months, year and a half? I don't know. We got the same thing on Owen Missing Road with the Matasota Salvage. There are three parcels of land there. He bought two. He's running his business on the third parcel, and according to records at the county recorders, Office of Deeds, he doesn't own that third parcel yet. And the previous owner is still living in it on the second floor in an apartment above an area where they're doing repairs on diesel trucks and so forth. We gave them, on that project, at least three 90-day extensions. I lost count. I would have to check my records. But the last extension we gave them could have been the fourth extension. And that would have been 4 times 90 days, would have been a year. On October the 2018, maybe it's not an architect, but they're, I got the wrong form here. Reading the wrong thing. I don't want to hold you up. No. No. I'm too highly organized that I lost my only work here.
This was, well, you're looking, Mr. Chairman, if I may. This is why I was suggesting that at some point when things are, you know, settled, that we have like a tracker of where these applications are, whether they're in preliminary or final, whether how many extensions, what the dates are, so because it's hard for us to, especially without having minutes, you know.
I brought this
where they stand, you know.
I brought this with me, but without wasting any more time, it's here. I'm just not finding it. His engineer or architect or whatever for Matos and project answered the planning commission, and it was recent. It was recent. I think April of this year rings a bell.
That seems right. Mm-hmm. And my notes are a little sketchy about that. I have on one set of notes that we gave them an extension, and then I have another set of notes. That we gave them preliminary approval.
We gave preliminary approval.
But correct. But then it went through to I think April. The thing expired. That last 90-day expired, I think, previous to April. But that April sheet that I have, the document is 3 or 4 pages long, and it was a rebuttal to everything that we were in opposition to, because I remember, so now what we agreed to, what we don't agree, that will be in bold letters and da 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 da. I brought that with me tonight. I don't know where it is, but they haven't contacted us again. There's no action on that. They've been running an operation there over a year and a half with no approval of this body. And right away, they'll take the one paper they got from the state. So we have state approval. We have state approval. No. That is one piece of the whole story. You don't have the final approval from this body, and you did not return to us the data documented of what we asked you to do. Now, that paper that they sent us, they tried to answer objectively, item by item, how they had already addressed those things. And basically what they were saying is, we did our work, we handed it in. We're sorry you found fault with what we did, but we did it, and we ain't doing it again. That's my paraphrase. And that's the nature of the communication that we received. I can't see why an order for cease and desist hasn't been issued. I brought that up before, and we said, give them another 90 days. Then we gave them another 90, then we gave them another 90. Now they don't even own that property where they're working. And there's an elderly owner involved. She has some issues. Maybe she's taken advantage of, I don't know. But that situation is not right. And It coincided with some of the things that, some of the issues that we had here that were brought up by Mr. Thomas. I don't believe this. Oh, I wonder why it was, see, I told you, my ear. Here it is. It was dated April the 4th, 2008. Attention to Mr. Zahner, our former planner, response letter for Matters Auto Salvage, and it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pages of rebuttal. I don't know if you found this. 7 pages of rebuttal for all the issues that we didn't agree with that project. But yet, the commercial operation continues.
Mr. Chairman, if you would allow staff to investigate and report, we can report back at the November meeting.
Absolutely, thank you. We appreciate that. And the one item that was similar in that project compared to this issue that we discussed tonight was, here we go. Based on planning principles, this is the one we discussed tonight. Based on planning principles, because there are stable residential neighborhoods directly bordering and adjacent to the same property, increased traffic, including trucks and commercial vehicles entering and departing the property by the only access available on Burn Street, will pass directly through these residential neighborhoods on Exeter Street. Find this depth, this noise, fumes will be detrimental to the continued stabilization of a residential neighborhood. Further, residential units are located along the truck's ingress and egress route, and trucking would not be compatible with it. So we addressed that issue by routing. Well, these trucks going through this residential neighborhood, we think that's a residential neighborhood. What do we call the 9, 8, and 700 blocks of Old Wyomissing Road? And it's R1. This one here today wasn't R1. This stuff going down to the Meadows plant is R1. And look what we're running through there, 24/7. And they must have 3 or 4 trucks there that could not pass the state police muffler test, no matter what they did to those trucks. I mean, they're wide open. They might have a muffler, but there's nothing inside the muffler. And going through traffic signs, traffic intersections, stop signs, you know. Now this is the same thing. Now this gentleman had some remediation to it. He suggested different truck routes, different this, different that, okay. We don't have that with this salvage yard, and yet with no approvals, he continues the business. I mean, you read the papers and what the townships do, and they're closing down operations and cease and desist for a lot less than that. So I think we've got to give this attention and get some closure to this thing. I am finished. Anything else for the good of the body, or for the soul, that matter? I can't believe this. Well, the discussion of the planning office work plan. You gentlemen wish to make some comments.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Thank you so much, members of the commission. We appreciate being here, and if I could speak for my senior planner, that's my nickname for senior planner. Got to go to
council is getting his position renamed, but I'm going to call him a senior planner.
Excuse, you might want to move closer to the microphones, or let him set it, yeah. Or let him set it up, yeah.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Wanted to present to the planning commission our work plan. I've given the work plan to staff, I've given it to acting managing director Osbert Deming. I've had some very fruitful discussions with Mr. Deming, so I'm very, very optimistic that we can move the planning program of the city forward. And there are a lot of people that are happy about that too. So I'm not going to take up a lot of time, I just want to give you an overview of our work plan. I know you haven't met, this body hasn't met in 3 months. Again, the inactivity, the lack of development activity in the city is concerning for many of us, concerned about revitalizing the city. That's a separate discussion. Actually, it's part of the discussion, but it's a separate discussion. What I want to focus on tonight is the work plan and focus your attention on moving forward to have what I would suggest to be a work session, Mr. Chairman, in the early part of 2019, where we can take our time and unwrap and unravel and unpack the elements of the plan and the zoning ordinance, the housing study, and there's a parking study going on as well. So we have a lot to chew on, we have a lot of work to do, and our mantra is going to be slow and steady. Rome wasn't built in a day, and so it's going to take us a while to address each and every concern. In case you didn't know, I'm a native of Philadelphia. I worked in Arlington County, Fairfax County, Stafford County, Virginia. I worked in the private sector, and so I appreciate the experience that I bring to bear here. I also want to caution that the jurisdictions that I work with did not blossom and bloom overnight either. It took years of planning and citizen involvement, and so I hope you gentlemen are up to the task. So let's roll up our sleeves and let's get to work. Very briefly, and again, we won't before you long, so we can have some discussion tonight, but I hope you don't want to tackle all of this tonight, because we can't. It's literally impossible. So let's move forward. What is the vision for Reading? That is my question to everyone who has a heart for the city. Is there a vision? My understanding, and this body can correct me if I am wrong, but there has not been an adopted comprehensive plan in the city of Reading for 50 years. Count them, 50 years. We've had plans that have been submitted, plans that have been discussed, but there has not been, repeat, there has not been an adopted comprehensive plan in this city in 50 years. And that is a travesty. Without a vision, the people perish. And so we need a stated vision for the city of Reading. We don't want to be a hodgepodge, all right? We have an architect in the room. I'm a frustrated architect. Many have taken architecture history classes. If you look closely at the photo, which I really like, the question is, what do we want Reading to look like? Do we want to look like that? Well, that is a hodgepodge. If you look closely, you have the Empire State Building there, or is it the Chrysler? I think the Chrysler Building is in there. You have the Twin Towers at Kuala Lumpur in there. You have a mix of skyscrapers from all over the world in there. And so we don't want to look like anything. We want to be specific, we want to be defined, and we want to have intentionality with the city. The city has a long and storied history, and we should take advantage of that moving forward. And so I challenge this body and the fathers of the city to think long and hard about what we want the city to be and what we want the city to look like. So I present to you several goals that I've challenged my staff with, and these are the goals we'll be working on with you moving forward. We need to adopt a comprehensive plan. I've said that several times, I'll keep saying it. We need to analyze and incorporate the best practices of previous studies and plans into an updated, and I want to emphasize updated. Right. There was an effort began in 2014
And that plan is, as Mr. Chairman mentioned, it was not received by many parties here in the city, and so it's languished. So what we want to do is to take it, dust it off, polish it up, and incorporate many of the valuable studies that have been already put forward. I have them here now, some of them, not all of them, I have some of them here now. There was a downtown 2020 plan, there was a neighborhood revitalization plan, there was an EPA study done, there was a study done by the Brookings Institution. All of these studies are valuable, and I believe many of them have merit, or portions of them have merit. It would be, I think, unfortunate to let them sit on the shelf. And so what I propose to do is to use staff resources and other resources to glean and to gather the best information, the best practices from these studies, put them together into the existing study, and move that forward for Planning Commission approval and recommendation to City Council. Again, I will be speaking with the Managing Director and look forward to meeting with the Mayor to unravel and unpack bit by bit these goals that we are recommending that we move forward on. So goal is adopt a comprehensive plan. Why plan? I love this. This is a picture of Daniel Burnham. Many say he's the father of modern city planning. This is his famous quote, "Make no little plans. They have no magic to stir men's blood, and probably they never, when they come back from behind here, they themselves will not be realized. Make big plans. Aim high and hope and work, remembering that a noble logical diagram, once recorded," he was wise enough to say that years ago, "you have to record it, you have to adopt it, it has to be official. All right, once it's recorded, it will never die, but long after we are gone, it will be a living thing asserting itself with ever-growing insistency." I love that last word, insistency. You've got to have a plan, all right? Every family needs a plan, every company needs a plan. We need to move forward, but we need to move forward under the guise of a plan. All right, the next goal is we need to focus on downtown. I've read the literature, and there is a lot of literature on revitalization of older Rust Belt downtown. All right, Bethlehem is one. Lancaster is another. We have sister cities to the north of us, to the south of us, that have, for lack of a better term, they figured it out. All right, gentlemen, Reading needs to figure it out. We need a strategic plan for downtown. All right, why downtown? We need to, first of all, list the priorities for creating complete streets and green downtown that will incorporate, again, the best practices of the previous plans and studies. So the question is, why downtown? All right, downtowns are the heart of a city and the region. They have a healthy heart, or rather, when you have a healthy heart, and this is a physical metaphor as well, when you're healthy, your heart is healthy. And so when you have a healthy downtown, it's essential to having a strong and vibrant region. Adam and I will be meeting with Shannon Rossman. She's with the Berks Planning Commission, and we're going to be discussing with her this very work plan and discuss moving forward. And certainly she has a wealth of experience and knowledge in the region, and she's offered her assistance, so we are actually going to take advantage of it, absolutely going to take advantage of her assistance. So we got to focus on downtown, all right? You can't ignore downtown. You can't say, well, let's just focus on the neighborhoods. You have to do both, but downtown is the core. Downtown is the heart and soul of the city, all right? To quote there. So there's a play on words, all right? Downtown is where it's at, right? It's where it's at. Historically, if you were looking for any good or service, where would you go to get it? Downtown, all right? Because we had sprawl, we had white flight, if you will, and the suburbs emerged, and then you have edge cities. Well, now the edge is expanding ever, ever wider. And so sprawl is not sustainable. It's not. Given the demographics now, the demographics of those that are moving back downtown, and Philadelphia is an excellent example. I grew up in Philadelphia in the 70s. You didn't want to even go downtown. Now, my son lives downtown. He lives a block from where my father used to work. It's just uncanny. He walks to work every day, walks his dog, loves living downtown. So we have to go back downtown, and we have to start at the core and work our way out. All right? What we need to do is to, well, we need to foster a walkable urbanism, is the key to the revival of any struggling downtown. These are the experts that are giving us these suggestions. So I like this quote, and I'll go ahead and read it. It is, again, from an expert at the Brookings Institution. People will walk, it's been observed, it's been calculated, that people will walk 1,500 feet or more only if they have an interesting and safe streetscape and people to watch along the way. We need a mix of sights and sounds that can make a pedestrian forget that he is actually unintentionally getting enjoyable exercise. Depending on the time of day, the day of week, or the season of the year, the experience of walking downtown will be an entirely different, even if you are traveling along a well-trod path. So why do we like to go downtown? We like the energy. We like the vibrancy of downtown, and that's what we need to create downtown Reading. A new experience can be had, in fact, nearly every time you take to the streets. We want that for Penn Street. We want that for Fifth. We want that for our core. And that has to be intentional. It just doesn't happen anymore. We have to be intentional about creating a vibrant downtown. All right, next goal. We need to complete the housing study. That's ongoing as we speak.
Yeah.
And that's something that Life Committee is working on. So I'll be working with Lee. I'll be working with Sipinski. I'm sorry to hear that, but you have your institutional knowledge and historical knowledge. What we need to do is to update the draft. We do have a draft, City of Reading Housing Improvement and Blight Elimination Plan. Adam and I have been touring. We have been gleaning and gathering information, so please don't think we've been sitting on our hands. We've been very busy. And we traveled to Bethlehem and we traveled to Lancaster to meet with their city officials, city staff, to discuss how they've dealt with their blight programs. It's evident that the term blight needs to be replaced. All right, it's a negative term. It's all about branding anyway, gentlemen. That's where we are. All right, downtown has to be branded. We have to sell downtown. And so we're going to sell it by not talking about blight. We're going to call it, and this is what it is, it's reinvestment. We want property owners to reinvest in properties all over the city, but especially downtown, and when we're dealing with housing, it is all over the city. We want to incorporate the best practices of other jurisdictions with successful, emphasis on successful, reinvestment plans, all right? Imitation is the highest form of flattery, and if someone is doing something that works, I think we should at least consider it, if not cut and paste. Moving on. Where will the middle class live? This is a very interesting discussion. Again, if you're a planner, if you're not, most of us are following this debate. We have a situation in the country where developers are building a lot of expensive luxury housing, and then there's a lot of affordable housing. But where is the middle? Where are the middle class living? Where do the blue collar workers from Reading Hospital live? Think about it. They hire, where will they live? All right, we need to think about that. We need to think about a middle-income housing stock. It's been sorely lacking for decades, so we need to provide for housing for teachers, for plumbers, for trade workers. This needs to lead to the vibrancy of especially the downtown and to the entire city. It helps recruit the best teachers and the other workers that are skilled to live in our city. So there's a term called the more, the less, all right? The more you do something, you create momentum, the more others will want to jump on the bandwagon. The less you do something, the less people will want to do it. And that is why, in my opinion, you've experienced a dearth of land development applications. No one is knocking on our door. No one is beating down our door to come to Reading. We're going to have to go out and attract businesses, housing, and retail. That's another facet we'll get into. So that's a quote. All right, so there's also, if you're not aware of it, there was an RFP put out for a parking plan. Tim and I sat on a panel. We're selecting a consultant to do a parking plan for the city. It's not just a study, it will be a plan. It would include multimodal transportation. We need to think outside the box, all right? It's not just about vehicles anymore. It's about moving people from point A to point B, and we need to think about that. So along that line, we need to complete an analysis of the supply and demand over the next decade and assess parking utilization downtown and in neighborhoods experience parking deficiencies. And there are certain pockets in the city that have serious parking deficiencies. We need to determine the strategies to guide long-range planning over the next decade, which will relieve the imbalance of parking in different parts of the city. So what's the big deal about parking? All right, one of the largest single land uses in municipalities, these footprints take up a lot of carbon. You've heard of the carbon footprint. Leave in school with some of that later, but buildings have a carbon footprint. A lot of the older parking garages in the city have a large carbon footprint, and we need to look at the viability of them, and we need to look at parking deserves more attention than it typically gets. It influences the character, the form, the function, and the flow of the city. So that's something that is overdue, and I'm delighted that that is going forward. Vibrant, economically viable downtowns are less car dependent and more focused on multimodal transportation. That's got to be a factor in this analysis and our moving forward. We cannot focus on the automobile only anymore. All right. And finally, what the planning office wants to do is improve our records management. We have, I'd say, thousands of records that are not digitized. That has to happen. It's not an option anymore. We're in a digital age. Applicants should be able to search online for documents, approvals of zoning hearing board applications, zoning permits, and even the planning commission approvals. That should be online, and that's a goal of mine for the department. And so we're going to scan all zoning and planning permits, plans, and studies, and make them available online. All right, that is my presentation. Thank you for your time. This is a lot of information. Again, I will answer any questions, general questions you may have, but I strongly suggest that we look at the calendar in 2019 and schedule several, one, two, three, or four, maybe one a quarter work sessions where we have just one item on the agenda like we had tonight. We can spend the balance of the time and spend an hour or two discussing an element of our work plan. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Good job.
Thank you, Mr. Honey.
Good job.
Well, what do you think, Mr. Beeler? You look pensive. Are we on our road?
So, we actually discussed a bunch of this at our meeting, and then I was giving feedback on the history of what I've seen in the past 15 years and how we've been repeatedly stripped of doing planning and just having to do work on the saldo while the administration makes up these plans with these ad hoc committees. And no offense to Mr. Olson, but he was on many of them.
He's made up a few.
And part of that just had to do with that we never really had staff. You know, we had Andrew for, 14 years? For 10 years, and he was the planning department.
One-man band.
Yeah, who often had to fight with his superiors. When I interviewed Mr. Hunter, one of the first things he said was that this is not happening on my watch. This is going to be a team that works together and gets things done. And right there, I was like, okay, we're going to move forward. So, because the first time I met Mr. Hunter was quite a few months ago, actually. I was asked by Mr. Steckman to come in and do an interview. And, you know, hopefully it was as good for Mr. Hunter to realize, you know, the hurdles we need to pass, as it was for me to understand, you know, what he was bringing to the table. So I'm just very glad that we now have the staff that we have.
I'm surprised that we spent as much time on the first consideration, but well, the only thing we had on the only customer that we did. I mean, sometimes there's no such thing as, well, you're spending too much time. You've got to maintain the integrity of what you're trying to do, whether it's zoning or planning or whatever. But at the same time, we're dealing with the customers who they don't have that expertise. They don't realize all that's entailed in their project. Maybe they don't have access to professional help, professional assistance. We know what happens when some of the quote big boys come in here and they have their design team, their architectural staff, 10 shirts and lawyers and the whole army ready for battle, and they're well prepared. Most of our clients don't have that. They don't have access to that. And then when they come here, we have to put them on the right track, but yet we don't want to take, we don't want to have victims, we don't want body count as part of our success. And it's difficult sometimes. They don't always know what we're talking about and how to get from point A to point B. And that, you know, we can suggest, for instance, in design changes. We're not supposed to design the project, but we're supposed to assist. Well, if you want a tree removed or a tree added, or you suggest different fenestration or whatever, how do you handle that? That's hard. And I've found that we have a tendency sometimes to beat up more on our local constituents rather than the chain operators. I remember the, what's out on Only Street, the auto parts place?
Which street?
On Only, AutoZone?
Oh, AutoZone.
Yeah. Remember that young lady who was the architect? She came in as a sole representative for that project. And she was an architect. She used to come in from Pittsburgh. You remember her?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And one night, we had a snowstorm or a terrific rainstorm or something nasty. And she had to get over the Reading Motor Inn. And she was staying over the night, and the next day she was going to drive down to Philly and get a plane back to Pittsburgh. Well, I thought, she give her instructions in the bypass, and she'll end up in Allentown. So I said, look, I'll drive very slow. Not much traffic now, it's 9:30 at night. You follow me, and I'm going to take you through part of town. But it would be the easiest way to get to Reading Motoring, because you will only have to make one right-hand turn when I let you go, and you're going to deadhead right into the Reading Motoring. Okay, so we did that. She got there, she got home, and then she came back. And whatever we asked her for, she'd come back the next time and she corrected her plates and she added something that she wasn't obligated to do. But she did it. And I think of the bottom dollar. Our greatest challenge, it only lasted 3 years and was torn down a few months ago. I asked about the Lancaster Avenue elevation. You know, this is plain Jane. It looks like a warehouse. So let's put some Fox windows in, and let's put some wall sconces on the side, and you might even want to take a miniature version of your logo and put it over here in the left-hand corner, sort of a little signature piece, so that we're adding another elevation to your endeavor, but we're really not raising the cost. Again, they were out of the area people, out of state, out of our neighborhood, and they adopted every change. We had no difficulty with those people, and they had something that was pretty nice. But yet our local people, they give us arguments, and we know so many engineers and the architects and the planners and the da-da-da-da-da that our worst nightmare, you see. I think that's always been the tricky part of what we do here.
Nobody in this room, of course. Nobody in this room, of course.
Of course not. Of course not. We didn't forget. But, I mean, that is that human nature, or is that a Berks County thing, or what? We feel more comfortable working with the out-of-towners who comply. 90% of the time, they comply with our non-mandatory recommendations. I don't know. That to me, that's always been an obstacle. And I hate to see we beat up on people. And usually when that occurs, it's our local people. See, I remember the, what do you call the thing over in Angelica, the lake, the...
Conservancy.
Remember,
the nature place.
Difficulties exactly. There. Yeah. And I knew the presenter personally. And I knew that she was having difficulty comprehending half of what we were saying that night. And we were just drilling her, just grinding her up. And what she was trying to do is comply and have a successful project, which they did get. They had a successful project. But I think she was placed in a very difficult situation, and I think a lot of our local people, it's happened to different jobs. Now, how do we avoid that? I've seen it many times here, but I don't know what the answer is.
I think part of it just has to do with the professionals that they hire.
Or they don't hire.
They just forget that this being the city of Reading, it's a whole different ballgame. Like, you know, we're the only planning commission that the buck stops here. Every other planning commission in Berks County, they have to go get supervisor approval.
I looked at this one, something in Burn Township with the behavioral health hospital. Well, I didn't look at the nature, you know, whether it was a good project or a bad project, but the thing that got me here was that the folks involved, the audience had no idea what a Saldo was. They had no idea what an MPC was. They did not know what Burn Township folks who were sitting as planning commissioners in lieu of a planning commission, because it's a small little borough, that what they were trying to comply with. So they looked at it as a personal thing. You guys don't care about our community, and you're doing this to me, and you're doing this to us. And then we had someone here who was a member of the commission, acting as a commission, tried to explain in 30 words or less what an MPC is and the sound of the responsibility of those two laws. And the person happened to be was either an architect or his father, I know his father was an architect, but had some architectural training and awareness. And they just went after this guy with knife and hatchet. And he was the enemy. He became the enemy. And he was trying to explain, then they said, well, why, you never mentioned this before, it's only because we walked in this room, and now you're going to crucify us and turn our community into something that is, and so forth. And they said, you haven't created anything like this for any other reason, meaning the other people got some kind of preferential treatment compared to us. You don't like us for some reason. So therefore, that's why you as a planning commission are treating us this way. And basically, he was explaining the Saldo and the MPC, and they didn't want to hear that. They didn't want to hear that. So I don't know what the ultimate, how this thing turns out. They're going to appeal and do all the stuff that you do, that they can rightfully do. But that's some of it. I mean, they were doing things, that commission was doing things that they had to do. And they didn't see any other way out. But there are ways out, because Saldo, Subdivision Land Development Ordinance, is statute law. Some of it has developed as case law where people appeal it, and then there were case studies that are used as reference in other court cases. But forget the element that says, or other governing ordinance or a state statute may counter what is in Saldo. That one isn't addressed. People don't know about that one. And different communities evidently have different ordinances that probably challenge Saldo, and it ends up in court, or else somebody backs down, and Saldo doesn't win in the end. These people didn't know that. An MPC, Municipal Planning Code, that's pretty specific. That one is, you shall do this and you shall do that.
That one basically lays out all the timelines and all of that stuff,
correct,
to make sure that
that's,
you
correct,
know,
that one is
they can't hold you up. But,
right,
you know, some communities,
that's right, that one,
some communities make you sign your rights away that are in the MPC.
That
most
more,
people don't understand that either.
More objective. But Saldo is more supposed to be objective. It's somewhat tends to be subjective. And to the average man on the street, you're not going to get that bottom. They don't understand it. Not that we understand a lot.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just comment on your
yes,
point. We've met with the Chamber of Commerce. There is a gentleman who is a liaison to the Hispanic business community, Giovanni by name. And that was him. We had a wonderful interaction, and we are on the same page with exactly what you just said, targeting our outreach to the community that's doing business, that wants to do business. I like what Lindsay said, Mr. Simpson. We are pro-business. We're open for business. We want businesses to come into Reading, but we need to help those that do not have professional representation, and they're trying to do it on their own, and they're struggling. And so we hope to, one of the many things I'd like to do is to do a workshop
for that population. It would be a soup to nuts, how to get through the red tape, how to get through zoning, how to get through the planning commission, how to get through the process, and we'd hopefully advertise as well, and hopefully get a good turnout, kind of running out of time this year. But it's I have a long wish list, as you can tell, and there's some things that you can do to help citizens and business owners get through the process. That's one thing that I'd like to do. So, point well taken.
Yeah, I think to David's point, what we need to add on the goals in 2019 as a community outreach, community engagement, and education. We need to educate the building public and the average public as to just what's involved, the rules and regulations, why they're there, what we follow, because many people don't understand it. And when they don't understand, they get very defensive. Well, why do I have to do this? And you need to be prepared to explain why, because it is the health and welfare and safety for themselves and the occupants of the buildings and the public in general. And yeah, we get updates on the codes on a regular continuing basis, and the codes become more and more restrictive, and it's the law. We cannot avoid it. And we find lots of times a client will go to a builder before they come to an architect, because architects are going to cost us money. Well, they're going to take a lot of time to design fancy stuff. I don't want to just give me a box. Well, because the box is easy, the box is cheap, and the box solves the problem. Sometimes the box is the answer. But when you look at the quality, that first slide that David showed, you know, we had the, it looked like the masthead of Financial Times magazine, which every major skyscraper in the world was on one city. That's not the city of Redding. We have a context with which into design. And that's what inspired me to ask the mayor if he would be interested in my submitting my application, because I was reading how you guys are getting hammered and you didn't have quorum. And I'm saying, you know what, I'm old enough in my profession, I've got enough experience under my belt, but I've been in front of you, and I have been attempting to educate my client base since my whole beginning of my career, and it's not easy. People don't understand why things cost the way they do, and it's hard to explain. And good design is good business, and we want to be open. We want to show people, you know what, so your initial cost is going to be a little bit more, but here's what you're going to get. Here's how it fits into the urban fabric. Sustainability. Try and tell somebody that spent a little more money today to save energy costs down the road. Energy never gets cheaper. And it's hard to explain to people that if you do rain screens, and if you do this, and if you do sunscreens, you're going to save energy. And the profession has become very complicated. So when I said to the mayor that I was willing to do this, because I want to, he looked at me and he said, who put you up to this? I said, nobody, just me. It's my time to give back to the community what it gave me. I've made my business here. And I'm at a point in my career with my company, and I want to dispel any rumors. I am not retired. I am not retiring. I have 6 more years before I turn 81, and then I'm done. So I relish my membership on the County Planning Commission, the Mount Penn Preserve. I was born and raised in this city. I remember when I was on the 18th floor on a Thursday night with my mother on the bus, and Penn Street from 2nd to 11th was a bustling community. You can never return to remember when. Redding is not the same city today as it was when I was growing up, but it's got damn good bones. Its demographics and its economic and ethnic structure has changed. Let's welcome it. And you know, let's help the people who are living here to make this a better place. So that's why I'm here. That's why I'm here. I have no axe to grind. I don't want to be chairman. I just want to do what I feel in my heart, and that is to make this a better place for the next generation. And
but you're still
coming back next month.
But you stay here long enough, and you will be chair, because we rotate the chair.
Oh, is that right?
We're a very dynamic group. We're the only ones in the city that rotate the chair. And we like to do that to send a message to some other groups within the city.
Wow. Okay? Well, I was chairman of the city of the County Planning Commission for 2 years, and I noticed the minute I was done, they put my name tag at the end of the table to get as far away from the center as possible. I thought I did a good job, but you know.
You did. But,
and then to meet David, and then to meet this guy, to we now have a staff, and I think the tide has turned. Talking with David, we're getting, it feels good. It really feels good, and I think this commission has taken a bad rap for a long time, and it's time to change that. We need to be looked to as problem solvers. We're not designers. I'm not going to sit here and say to an architect, you know, did you try putting the windows this way? You know, it's not my job. My job is to make sure that it's the best building or the best complex for that site, for the city, and it meets all of our requirements that are legally, that we're legally responsible for. And be innovative and be creative. Good design is good business. I have clients whose businesses have increased in value because of their building, who have no turnover because we've created a building for their employees who now used to come to work in t-shirts and jeans, now wears pantsuits and dress because it has enlivened them. It has given them a fresh approach to their business, to their way of life. They like coming to work. That's what architecture and design and planning is all about. Not just putting the damn box up and, you know, stuff in and stuff out. There's a lot more to it.
I didn't want to design a bottom dollar.
Absolutely.
I couldn't see going down, up and down Lancaster Avenue every day for the rest of my short life, looking at a box on Lancaster Avenue or a warehouse.
I know exactly the box you're talking about. I'm so glad to be here. I'm so glad for these guys. I'm so glad that the staff is gelling and I think our future looks pretty bright for going forward. So I'm glad I'm here, and I will be back next month.
We're glad you're here, but we failed to tell you about a tradition we have when we get rookie planners on the planning commission.
Do I have to buy the first round?
Jimmy Cramer's.
All right.
All right, do we have a motion to adjourn?
I don't know.
Wait a second. Go ahead.
I'll be real brief. Just a couple of quick things. That I'm very pleased, of course, and I'm sure Commissioner also would agree, at the focus on developing and finalizing the city's housing plan. It's something that on Blighted Property we were very much concerned about. That definitely is something the city needs, so appreciate that. For our new colleagues' benefit, and you know, for the general public as well, just pick up briefly on what Commissioner Peeler was getting at. The bulk of what we do is approving applications. It really isn't so much planning. The exception, of course, is on the comprehensive plan. So we've done some work on it to improve what the city contracted for. You know, whatever can be salvaged of that and then added to, I just want to say I'm thrilled with the whole approach on the whole planning office work plan, and I can't wait till we have our workshop so we can get back to a comprehensive plan and do some real planning and you know, finalize the thing, and which I guess it'll be timely for 2020 anyway, as I said before when I presented before the council. And because it is a document that we do refer to, even if it's in its draft form, when it comes to the plans. So, and of course, we'll discuss what weight it should have, what it has legally, what it does have, and what it should have, and how the city can best put it to use. And so I very much look forward to doing that. So thank you for that presentation.
Anything else for the good of the order? Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Adjourn.
And a second.
Second.
We are unanimous. Thank you, folks.